the wisdom for the world. Now, when we talk about wisdom, we have to figure out first, what are we talking about? This here is my bookshelf, my office. Fill the books. And as you can see, I'm starting to pack up. Don't worry, I'm not leaving yet. But throughout this past year, I have been reading tons of books, gaining knowledge, information. But that's not wisdom. Wisdom is how we apply what we learn. Here's an example. Take a high schooler, AP student, knows everything from class. Put them in a real life situation, and they might struggle how to figure things out. Take another student, might not have those same top grades. But if you put them in that real life situation, they succeed, they thrive. What's going on here? Well, it's called everyday wisdom, having common sense. It's how we live our life and go forward. Now, our world has its own idea what wisdom is. Now, to help picture that, I want you to follow along with me with the idea of a bowl. A bowl is a piece of pottery that is formed by a potter. And when a bowl looks around and sees all the other pieces of pottery around it, it goes, I might be a plate, actually. You know what? I am a plate. In our culture, we celebrate, we cheer the bowl for saying such things. But it doesn't stop there. Because what happens is the bowl goes, you know what? Since I think I'm a plate, that means I've been formed by the potter incorrectly. So I need to be the one to fix it. So the bowl goes and fixes it to make itself into a plate. In our culture, that bowl is treated like a hero. Now you might be thinking what I'm getting at here. You might be thinking to yourself, preaching, Vicar, we need to hear this. But that's not where I'm going. You see, the issue that we're talking about here with the bowl is the same issue each of you are dealing with. This isn't some issue that was started by a bunch of lawsuits and court hearings the last couple years. This issue wasn't brought up in the 60s. It's an issue that goes back all the way to the beginning, when the relationship between God and man was severed. I'm talking about the fall. When we talk about the fall, that sin entered a world, we have a couple of people we come to mind. Adam, Eve, a serpent, and a piece of fruit. We teach this in Sunday school. We teach it all the time throughout our lives. But I want you to think about for a second. Why did Adam eat the fruit? Why did Eve eat the fruit? See, on that moment in our history of our world, man said, I want to be God. The creation said, I want to be the creator. The pottery said, I'm the potter. In that time going forward, our relationship with our Father has been broken. This past year, I've had the opportunity to teach confirmation, to teach the Ten Commandments. And one of the things my confirmands know is that no matter what thing you do, no matter what sin, what commandment you break, you always break one commandment, every time. What that commandment is, you shall have no other gods before me, the first commandment. The reason why is because every time you do something against God, against what the Bible has to say, you are putting yourself first. That's the true issue. You're saying that you're God, you're the creator, you're the potter. And when you do that, you're making a point that it's all about me. That's what the world wants to get in everybody's head. That's what they want you to think about. It's all about yourself. Well, what does the wisdom of God have to say? Well, we have this opportunity to read from Proverbs. Now, for a lot of us, Proverbs is this book full of all these little nuggets of valuable wisdom things to live by. Here's some examples. As a dog returns to its vomit, So fools repeat their folly. It's a reminder that if you don't learn from your mistakes, you're going to keep repeating them. This next words of wisdom. I'm not going to make a comment. Gentlemen, just listen for me. Better to live on a corner of the roof than share a house with a quarrelsome wife. Words of wisdom to live by. So is that all Proverbs are? Just a bunch of little snippets that we can chuckle at and laugh at as we read it? No. In fact, Proverbs starts off the first 9 chapters as a letter from Solomon to his son Rehoboam. See, Solomon was the wisest king of Israel. And he knew he needed to find a way to pass that wisdom down to his son. Because his son had to make a choice when he grew up. And how Solomon describes it, he's going to have a choice between 2 kinds of women. Foolishness and wisdom. Foolishness is this beautiful, attractive, seductive choice. Foolishness promises all the treasures of the world. All you have to do is go to her. But Solomon wants his son not to look that way, but keep eyes forward. To listen for, to seek wisdom. And this is what Solomon says to his son. Does not wisdom call out? Wisdom is not something we have to obtain. Wisdom is not something we have to figure out. Wisdom is calling to us to come to her. Later, as Solomon's writing this, he says, but this, on what wisdom says, I raise my voice to all mankind. Wisdom is calling out to us. Wisdom is not supposed to be held by just one people group, not just one denomination. The wisdom of God is meant for all. In the rest of our reading from Proverbs, Solomon goes on to explain who wisdom is. That wisdom was there before creation. Wisdom saw when the earth was formed, when the water sprung out. You start to think about it. Wisdom doesn't sound like some just grand idea that you should find. Wisdom sounds like a person. Well, who is this person? Solomon ends before reading today saying, Then I was constantly at his side. I was filled with delight day after day, rejoicing always in his presence, rejoicing in his whole world, and delighting in mankind. This goes back to Genesis chapter 1. When God finished creating everything, he said it was very good. At the very beginning, wisdom was there, delighting in man, in God's creation. So if wisdom is this person, who are we supposed to seek out? Who are we supposed to listen to? That's where our gospel reading comes into play today. Where the Gospel of John focuses on telling us who wisdom is. But before we get to John chapter 8, we get to start at the very beginning. Verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. John is making a point with Solomon that wisdom was there in the beginning. He uses the word, logos. In Greek, logos meant all knowledge, all wisdom, all the thought in the world, everything that makes it exist. If you could understand logos, you would understand the word, the mind of God. And then John goes on and makes the point that word, that person, was in the beginning, was with God. So there's God and the Word. But that person, the Word, was God. John is pointing to a relationship here. If we were to read further, John makes the point that Word came down to be with mankind. God came down to be with man. The Creator came down to be with creation. The Potter, the Pottery. Well, that's a hard thing to grasp, the idea that God came down to us. And that's where our gospel reading picks up with Jesus having a discussion with the elders about this. This idea of who Jesus is, who the Father is, and the relationship. He goes on to say that my job as the Son is to honor the Father. The Father, as Jesus says here, if I glorify myself, my glory means nothing. But my Father, whom I claim as you claim as your God, is the one who glorifies me. The Father and the Son are in this relationship, working with one another. That's a hard statement to believe. In fact, as you got done reading the gospel, they wanted to stone Jesus for saying something like this. This whole idea of God coming to be with us, with his creation, scares people. It scared them so much, the idea of God becoming man, the idea of the potter becoming pottery, they eventually kill Jesus. They crush him. And for them, they were hoping that was the end of the story. But it's not. For that piece of pottery was made anew. It was risen alive. Because of what Jesus has done, our relationship with our Father, the Creator, the potter, that has been separated, is mended. We can come to him. We can go to him. Because of what Jesus has done. And if we live our life with that understanding that our relationship with God has been mended, that's wisdom. Your take home this week, which is also in your announcement bulletin, I have a challenge for you to start you off. I want you to take time this week to ponder, to chew on. Take time to chew, and then to say out loud, God is forming me. He is by my side. When you say this, you're making a point that God is your creator. You are in his hands and he is forming you. But you're also saying, you're not alone. He's with you. Now to go through this, I have three devotionals. The first one is, remember that we are your creation, Father in heaven. The first point, the wisdom, is understanding who we are to God in his creation. The devotional for this week goes through Isaiah. And at this point, the people of God realize something very scary. We're not the one in charge. There's powers at hand that are fighting back and forth. We're like nothing. We're nothing but clay. Yet you, O Lord, are our Father. We are the clay, you are the potter, we are all the work of your hands. It is a very scary, a very humbling point when you realize you are not the one in charge. It reminds me of Proverbs 9. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The fear is not running around and hiding in caves and being scared of God, but realizing he is the one in charge. He is the creator, you are the creation. He's the potter, you're the potter. And when you have that relationship with your Father, you can grow. But that's only a relationship that happens through Jesus. That can be really difficult to talk about, to think about, this idea that we can be with this universal creator of all things in our life. The early church kind of struggled with this. And that's why the point here is wisdom is seeing every moment of our life that God is forming us. He is with us. The church of Rome struggled so much, Paul had to call them out and say this. But who are you, human being, to talk back to God? So what does form say to the one who formed it? Why did you make me like this? Paul is telling the church back then, you need to take a step back and realize who's in charge. That God is forming you. He is with you. This Trinity Sunday, we talk about Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. When we say that he is with you, what I mean by that is that when you pray today, this week, you are praying to your Father in heaven. You pray to him in the name of his Son. Jesus is praying with you when you go to the Father. And the words on your heart and your mind as you pray come from the Holy Spirit. You are surrounded by God in this relationship. But it's not just prayer. Every breath you make, every step you take, God is with you. And when that is on your mind, that is how you're living out wisdom. This goes to our last point. Wisdom comes from the Father. True wisdom is Jesus our Lord. When we apply our lives with this understanding that Jesus is the one in charge, that's how we live out our life. Paul says this, for him all things were created. For all things were created, things in heaven, things on earth, visible and invisible. Whether the thrones or the powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. When you realize that you have been created for God, and that you are here for his purpose, to help share who he is to those outside, that is the beginning of wisdom. I leave you with this note about these words from David. Therefore my heart is glad, my tongue rejoices, my body also will rest in hope. That hope is the wisdom of our Lord who's in charge. That is a wisdom for the Lord. Amen.